Hello, I'm Alicia Malone, the co-host of Women Make Film on TCM. Welcome to this very special conversation held in collaboration with Loyola Marymount University's School of Film and Television in support of TCM Presents Women Make Film. And today we're joined by three fantastic women. First up, we have producer Janet Yang. She is an SFTV Presidential Fellow and a clinical professor with LMU. And her work includes the 1993 film The Joy Luck Club, a groundbreaking movie, a rare American feature to have an all-star Asian cast. And this film earned critical acclaim for its portrayal of Chinese immigrant families. And Janet also serves as governor at large of the Academy of Motion Pictures Arts and Sciences. And her firm, Janet Yang Productions, continues to develop projects that empower underrepresented voices. Hi, Janet.
Hello. Nice to see you.
So glad to have you with us today. And we also have Mary Kuryla. Her feature film Freak Weather premiered at Toronto and was in competition at the International Film Festival Rotterdam. And her award-winning short film Memory Circus premiered at Sundance. She's also won several awards for her novels and short stories, including the Grace Paley Prize for Short Fiction and the Pushcart Prize. And Mary is currently a clinical assistant professor of screenwriting at LMU. Welcome, Mary.
Thank you for having me.
I'm so glad you're here. And we're also very pleased to have with us director Susan Seidelman. And she's going to be sharing insight into her experience as being a female filmmaker. And her work includes Desperately Seeking Susan, She-Devil, and several episodes of Sex and the City, including the pilot. And today we'll be focusing on her 1982 film Smithereens, because we are airing that film as part of our Women Make Film series on TCM in our section on endings. Hi, Susan.
Hi, nice to be here. Thank you.
And I wanted to actually start with you, Susan, because I'm always curious to hear how women come to filmmaking and want to study film, especially because a lot of what is studied in film schools is traditionally movies made by men, which sort of engenders this idea of filmmaking being the domain of men. So you came into wanting to study film when you were already at college, is that right?
Yes, I went to the grad school at NYU, and originally I had wanted to be a fashion designer. And when I started film school, this was in the early, it was 1974. Film schools weren't that popular. And to be quite honest, it was probably less competitive to get in because I had never made a film before. I knew I liked watching them. And, I kind of applied not on a whim, but partially because I liked watching movies, partially because I wanted to move to New York from Philadelphia. And but what happened is once I started to actually make films, the hands-on experience, I thought this is, something pretty amazing, and that it pulled together all my other interests, like design, like music, like just love of characters. But again, I didn't go in with the goal, I want to be a film director. I just went in with the goal, I like movies, I get a chance to watch them and be around other people who like movies.
And did you have a chance in Philadelphia to be exposed to many different types of films?
No. I grew up in suburban Philadelphia, where basically we're talking about the 60s and early 70s. I saw what was at the local shopping mall cinema. So for me, suddenly going to New York and actually being at a place where there were so many repertory theaters, I probably spent, my first couple of months in New York just seeing 5, 6, 7 movies a week. But literally, when I started film school, 77, I didn't know of any women film directors. I had heard of Ida Lupino, but I knew her basically as an actress. And I was starting to hear about some European women, like Lena Wertmüller, who started directing a bunch of interesting movies at that time, Agnes Varda. But in terms of American female directors, Ida Lupino. there weren't a lot of female role models for a female film student at that time.
And Mary, what about you? Because you actually worked at a rep theater, is that right?
Yeah, when I went to, in college, I think I worked at like four different rep theaters in Boston. And that's where I learned all my cinema, whether it was like a repertory of Kurosawa or New German Cinema or Hitchcock. Yeah, so, but that's how it was, right? Because we didn't have Google and streaming. We actually had to go to the movies. And if you worked at it, it was even more of an education. But like Susan, I went to graduate school at USC for film production. And there were very few role models for women filmmakers. And probably my main role models were European women filmmakers, whether it was German women filmmakers. I mean, I remember when the first semester, I always feel like this is a good anecdote, because the first semester in production, they went around the room. I think I was the only woman in the class. And that's even in 85. And they said, who are your influences? And somehow the great filmmakers of the 70s and early 80s had vanished. And every student said either Lucas or Spielberg. And then it got to me and I said, German women filmmakers. And I remember I made a lot of friends that day, but there were women making films in Germany at that time, because there was the subsidized cinema, and they were making interesting films. But I wanted to say something that I think is a little bit, maybe is worth mentioning, is that sometimes I think of that period where from the time that Susan went to school and then I went to school and then maybe another 5 or so years after, where I actually think it was the feminist film theory people who were making a bigger impact on women's filmmaking in a weird way than the filmmaking. Because at least they could talk about cinema. You didn't have to, you know, put up a production. And I think they've been extraordinarily influential. And I feel that it's a kind of a forgotten legacy, because I think that they kept the whole notion of women making movies alive in their analysis and in their innovative critiques of cinema. And they were at UCLA and NYU and USC, those really impressive film critics, and abroad as well.
Yeah, I think, you know, when you look at someone like Molly Haskell, and even just the way that she could look at the mainstream Hollywood films through a female lens and give something different to it. You know, when did you start to think that you wanted to get into filmmaking and screenwriting in particular?
Well, I had studied photography too. I wanted to make films and I wanted to write them. And it just seemed like going to film school was the right path. As same with Susan, it wasn't that hard to get in. I mean, I think I had a couple of short films, but it didn't seem very competitive. And it wasn't that hard to stay. You know, all I had to do was actually just try to make them. But then I think, though, for me, I just never wanted to make very mainstream work. Susan's film was a influence for me. I only wanted to work with women characters that are not behaving within expected boundaries. It's all I'm interested in my work. And I found that was prohibitive then and remains to some extent prohibitive. There's still a lot of limits around it. So I wanted to do it in college. It was probably in college where I started to have that longing.
And Janet, what about you? How did you come to the path of producing, and what was the landscape like for women at that time?
Well, unlike Susan and Mary, I didn't go to film school. I never even imagined I could work in the film industry at all. Not only was I a woman, but I was Asian. I never saw anything on screen that remotely gave me the encouragement that this was something I could do. But I came in a rather strange way. I went to live in China after college just because I was very, very curious. And I started seeing these incredible films from this burgeoning generation of filmmakers. They call them the fifth generation filmmakers, the now very famous Chen Kai-ge and Zhang Yimou and whatnot. And I just got so excited. I was an avid film watcher. I was living in New York in Tribeca, close to Film Forum. That was basically my film education because they would show films from all over the world. So I was absorbing all this wonderful film. But as I said, never did I imagine I would be behind the camera. But after showing these films, I started going back and forth to China and picking ones and meeting filmmakers. And I got so excited about their films. And I was in a way serving as a kind of a producer, advising them about marketing and what was good and what was not. And then I was hired by the studios to sell American studio films to China. So I was doing the reverse. I was picking from these giant catalogs of the studio films to see what would be a good product to put before a Chinese audience, which had been basically isolated for many decades. So in a strange way, I was coming from a distribution marketing sense, perhaps, but because of all the work I was doing in China, I got that amazing call one day from Kathy Kennedy's office, who said Steven Spielberg wanted to make a film in China. That film ended up becoming Empire of the Sun, and I worked very, very closely. I had nothing to offer, of course, as a film producer type, except that I knew China and the film industry there. So I was able to help get all the permissions and work with each of the departments and find their Chinese counterparts. And so I got an unbelievably privileged bird's eye view from the best in the business as Kathy's mentee. And that led to a job working at Universal Studios and on the Amblin account. I got very antsy in a studio executive job. And then when a filmmaker who had actually come to these Chinese film festivals I was organizing years earlier said he was starting his company, that person being Oliver Stone, I ended up joining him to make films. And that was where a whole new education began for me of really being able to make kind of independent-minded films, but under the studio system.
Yeah, I mean, you didn't go to film school, but you got a very good education with some of those filmmakers. So when you were looking through these catalogs of films, did you notice anything particular when it comes to Asian representation and also women in these movies?
Well, there was virtually no Asian representation, so I wasn't even going to begin to find anything. I think that was appropriate. And if I had found any Asian character, it would have been a rather insulting one, a rather offensive one. So I, if anything, avoided those because you might have seen a prostitute or a buck tooth, might have been Mickey Rooney in Breakfast at Tiffany's and not a real Asian person. So they were really looking with the first films that we brought over were gentle films, meaning that they hadn't, if at the time there was Star Wars and there was Back to the Future, those films would have probably blown their minds. They might not have ever caught on to what they were about. So we started gently with the newest film that we brought over was Love Story. And then we brought over Roman Holiday. I actually accompanied Gregory Peck to go over there and films like that. But I can't think of a single female filmmaker, unfortunately. That was the state of Hollywood at the time. That there really was none. On the other hand, there were Chinese filmmakers, female filmmakers that I was watching and tracking. And I would say today the ratio of female to male filmmakers in China is much more balanced than it is here.
Oh, wow. That's interesting. And Susan, for you, when you first came to make Smithereens, this was a time before what we think of as the independent boom of the 1990s. And it has had a small budget, but were there challenges involved with getting together financing? Did people understand what exactly you were trying to do?
Yeah, well, the budget was only initially about $40,000, and I never had all of that at once. It was sort of dribs and drabs, and the film was shot over a period of 2 years. But if I'm really honest, I'll say one of the things that served me well was my absolute naivete about how hard it would be. And I think if I wasn't so just determined to make a movie because this was the story I wanted to tell, and also just dumb about how the business worked and naive about knowing how dismal the statistics were, I think that would have blocked me in some way, would have, you know, somehow impaired my enthusiasm. But just being kind of like, hey, you know, let's put on a show in the barn, in spirit anyway, was what enabled me to do it. I mean, I never even thought you had to have all the money at once. I just thought, you know, you get a little money, you film a little, you get a little more. So it was a little bit of an extension from my film school experience. And the crew was made up of the people I had met at NYU. I think one of the things as I got more and more involved in the business and I started suddenly, you know, realizing there are agents and there are studio executives and there's development people that are going to give you notes and all those things. Then I realized, oh, this is far more complicated if you want to make Hollywood movies than I had imagined. But Smithereens was really just a long extension of making a film school movie.
Did that spirit help you as well when you were out on the streets of New York and just, you know, following around this spunky character with a camera?
To some extent, yes. Again, not having any money and not having, you know, I didn't even know about film permits. I didn't know that you needed to get a permit from the city of New York in order to film in the streets. So we would just drive around, find a location, an empty lot, for example, where one of the characters parks his van. Just, you know, in probably one of the most dangerous parts of the city under the West Side Highway in the 40s, we just, you know, parked a van there and filmed for a bunch of days, sometimes staying, you know, all night, sometimes leaving the van there, going home, coming back, without knowing the protocol. But I think if I had realized how much was involved in the professional way, I'm not sure it would have deterred me. It just might have slowed me down a little bit.
And Mary, what about you when you first came to screenwriting, which can have a very strict structure to it sometimes, if you think about the sort of save the cat model with the different beats? Did you have that kind of naive spirit of going in and changing things up, or was there creativity within those limitations?
Well, I think it's one of the principles that I teach my students is that I think it's very useful to know the basic structure of any given Hollywood form screenplay. And so I would say that I worked with the basics of three acts and a want and a need for the character. And even watching the Borat movie that just came out, it's interesting to see that how sort of really traditional the narrative structure is, like absurdly traditional, and you can see it a mile away. And yet it really points to how you really need that very solid framework of a kind of conventional form narrative, especially if you want to push the boundaries formally or in terms of your provocations with your character or whatever you're going to experiment. It seems to me the more necessary you need it to be for kind of conventional structure to undergird it. So in that way, yes, I was careful to give a very clear want for my character because I knew that she would test the audience in other ways.
So Mary, for you, what was the challenges and the surprises when you started to write screenplays?
Well, I didn't particularly have any challenges writing for myself, except for that I just didn't think I was ever writing well enough. It's one of the reasons I went back to short story writing and novel writing, and I just wanted to be a better writer than I was. But when I started to do it for hire, I worked for Mr. Mudd, and my first book adaptation was a novel for John Malkovich to direct. I found that more difficult because you know, you're working with a pre-existing form, a novel. And so you're trying to draw that book. I think I got that job because I was the only one who actually read the book for the interview, because it was so unreadable, that book. It's much more challenging. And I feel like when you write a screenplay that you want to make a movie from, it's a really different process than if you write for hire, like an adaptation, because then you're pleasing a group of people and you're going to try to work with the director and his or her interpretation rather than writing for your own film. When I think about, honestly, one of my heroes is Jean-Luc Godard. And to me, he's somebody who really was trying to sort of forget about the other traditions in film, in the cinematic process. So I try to think about that when I think about making something that I would want to shoot.
And speaking of books to film, Janet, one of your early projects was being the executive producer on the Joy Luck Club, which we now look back on and see just how landmark and groundbreaking it was. Unfortunately, because we haven't had much Asian representation in American film since then. But did you know at the time that this was going to be something historic?
How could one possibly, does one ever know? No, but especially one that broke all the rules. First of all, having an all-Asian cast, having be a quarter to a third of it being in Mandarin Chinese, having so many different storylines, having a lot of flashbacks. In so many ways, this movie broke every rule. Where that book is, I'm not sure, but there's a book somewhere with all the rules. And we just abided by them. You know, you're not supposed to do this, you're not supposed to do that. But we just felt it was worth adapting the book in the most authentic way possible. Unfortunately, we had one backer, Jeffrey Katzenberg, who supported us. Everyone else said no to the project. And yes, now looking back, we think, oh, well, of course. One thing I know, I was very, very clear with Amy that she had to be involved in the writing because it was all about the voice. And strangely, the manuscript was presented to me on a trip that Kathy Kennedy took me on to New York, where we were meeting with publishers. The book had not yet been published. They only had three discrete chapters. They were unrelated, so we didn't even know how it was all going to tie together. But I instantly read something that spoke to me. I had never, ever in my life read anything that was so close to my life. And I just thought, being blind and inexperienced to the ways of the world, I said, I'm going to help you make this into a movie. And somehow the book became a bestseller, and somehow the movie got made, and somehow it's become kind of a memorable film for many people. And one never knows. One never, ever knows. I just, on a lark, worked on this other movie that ended up being the number one movie on Netflix this weekend, an animated movie. I'd never done animated movie, but with a girl protagonist who builds a rocket to the moon to meet the moon goddess. And so they all seem somewhat preposterous, but you just hang on to your vision and your dream, and sometimes the movie gods shine a light on it.
And I think something that you all have in common is telling stories that aren't necessarily told all the time in the mainstream. So Janet, as a producer, you do have to hold on to that hope or that belief, or do you think finding a story that is different from what is out there is actually a good way to speak to an audience that doesn't normally get catered to?
I think it's a mix. You can't be completely oblivious to taste, but you also don't want to rehash. I don't, anyway. And I think most films that stand out are not rehashing anything of the past. They are putting something original out. But it is a balance because, and I've actually read up on definitions of creativity, because at one time I was working with someone who came in from outside the business, and he kept pumping me with questions like, how do you know if something's going to work? What is creativity? And it is actually, many people have commented on this, Ed Catmull from Pixar to David Chang, the chef, to many people. And it is this strange combination of familiarity and something that's unfamiliar. So people seem to want to enter new worlds, but you have to ground them in something that feels at least a little comfortable, so they feel they're walking on firm ground. And I've kept that in mind. So with Joy Luck Club, clearly the specifics of the culture are very, very different, but the universal dynamics of families, you know, parents who have a lot of expectations of their children, that's the part that's universal. So I think that's where a broad appeal comes in. If you can find that universal thread, and I think the same thing for Over the Moon takes place completely in China, but it is something very familiar about family relationships.
Susan, do you agree with that when it comes to Smithereens? Because it's so funny to watch this movie now and you see this girl who is taking selfies and posting herself all over New York and you think, wow, that's quite prophetic. But it's a timeless story that appeals.
Yeah, I wanted to mention something about structure, because I think structure is very satisfying, not when you duplicate the same thing that's been done a million times before, but structure, it's like architecture. You need to be able to hold up your story. And the storytellers that I've liked the most have been those who could take that structure and twist it to overlay their own point of view on it. And to me, when without that structure gives me a certain amount of freedom. For example, Smithereens does have has a three-act structure, and it has character arcs and all those traditional things. I just applied it to characters I hadn't seen a lot in other movies. And if you look at even, Desperately Seeking Susan, that is just a twisted up screwball comedy. And it's sort of a love story underneath it all, or an infatuation story between two women instead of a guy and a girl. So, but the structure and some of the dynamics are very traditional and have already kind of passed the test of, I know that those things are satisfying. When I look at somebody like, who really make Quentin Tarantino, whether you like him or you don't, you realize that he took, a beginning, middle, and end and just twisted them around and didn't put them in the traditional order, but yet that's what made it satisfying. So back to Smithereens, part of the motivation was a little bit inspired by, my sudden interest in European cinema that I had not seen before, specifically the kinds of waif-like characters that you would see in French and Italian cinema that you just didn't see per se in American cinema. I acknowledge my sources. I mean, Smithereens, the character was very influenced by my love for Giulietta Messina in Knights of Cabiria. I just loved that gamin kind of character. And, I even sort of was inspired by what she was wearing, that little fuzzy bath mat turned into a jacket. The ending of Smithereens was very inspired by 400 Blows. That ending that is kind of a question mark, where somebody's pushed up against a wall in 400 Blows, the character of Antoine Doinel, finds himself up against the sea and can't go any further. In this case, Ren, who is always very feisty throughout the entire movie, finds herself alone on the West Side Highway, up against the river, and in the background is the bridge to the place she doesn't want to go, which is New Jersey. It happened to be the George Washington Bridge. Again, I'm referencing things that I loved, but twisting them to overlay my own point of view, or themes that I thought were interesting on top of them.
Is that the same for you, Mary, when it comes to writing novels? Is there a structure that you follow and then you can tweak it from there, particularly in the way that you write women, which aren't, women that fit neatly into some kind of box?
Yeah, I rely pretty immensely on my my sense of screenplay structure and traditional three-act, or how Susan was describing it also. In part because, yes, I do try to push the maybe the reader's tolerance for the behaviors of the female characters that I write, but also because literary novels have a reputation for not being very structured, not being very driving in a narrative. And because I also like to experiment with form, I find that it's useful to, again, hold the, sort of center it with the fact that it has tensions, and what you're reading, what the stakes are, and that sort of will keep you possibly in the work, because you know what you're reading, you know what you're trying to find out in the story, and then I can kind of play with more Brechtian models and stuff. But I do also think that, you know, literature has tolerated sort of different points of view and different kinds of models of female heroines than that who are very flawed. We've had that in literature a lot more historically than you've seen in cinema. Maybe largely written by men, but that's been picked up in the last 50 years or more by women writers. And in fact, there's some women writing now, someone like Otessa Mosfeg, who are only writing really, really, you know, really, really edgily behaved female characters, or Mary Gateskill. And so those women were also really important to me in terms of influences and respect. Kathy Acker, many writers that that I don't think really has still, to some extent, caught up in American filmmaking, even in TV or any ideas people have. Because I feel like it's still falling along genre lines. Like if a woman is truly flawed and very poorly behaved, then she's going to tend to be an antagonist, or you know, a kind of negative figure. And there's still these. I feel like the division between good and bad is still pretty marked. And I really feel very strongly until female characters can be very, very colored and very, very good and bad and immensely flawed. I feel like that's really at the core of making the change toward a more egalitarian cinema.
Yeah, Janet, do you feel the same as well when it comes to the scripts that you read featuring women and particularly Asian characters, that it's more about seeing the true kind of characters that can be messy? You know, they don't have to always be likable, always fit into one particular stereotype or one particular box.
I do feel like there's been a change in recent years, and it does help that first there was an African-American blockbuster, Black Panther, and then a female directed one with a female star playing a superhero, of course, Wonder Woman. And then we had our Crazy Rich Asians. So all of this helps in just in terms of paradigm shifts. I think also I really believe that the streamers have helped flatten the world, because it used to be you had to gather the maximum number of people at the same time, at the same place. So there was this appeal to a low common denominator, or at least to what the demographic bulge that was most important to them, that 18 to 35 white male. So that was a huge handicap to all of us who wanted to make films with underrepresented voices. And that has fortunately changed. And I love the fact that a pair of eyeballs in Indonesia or Greece or Venezuela or wherever is as important to the streamers as it is in North America. And the fact that people can find what they like when they want it is really a big boost. And I do feel a big change in the projects that I'm working on now, to be able to lean into the authenticity of it, to not whitewash the characters or not make the female characters just be some trope or whatever. Quite the contrary. I think people do want originality and they do want something just authentic. And so I feel very hopeful. I had sort of given up on Hollywood for a while. I'd come back to China and I was doing other things. I just thought, where am I going to make the things that I want to make? But I now feel like it is possible to do it right here and right now.
And in addition to all of your experience in your careers, each of you have taught young filmmakers, which I imagine there must be a lot of optimism when you get to interface with these young people. So I want to ask each of you, starting with you, Susan, how can the industry support these young filmmakers, particularly the young women?
Well, I do think that there are a lot more opportunities. I also think we're going through a really crazy time. I mean, we have to acknowledge that this is an unprecedented time. And if I'm really honest, you know, I love going into a movie theater and seeing, getting lost and seeing something up on a big screen. I don't know when I'm going to do that next. I honestly don't. I guess the good news is that because of all this, the sources for streaming these days and all the international series and movies that are now available to just regular viewers. I was talking to my mother the other day. My mother's 89 years old and she said, I can't talk to you right now. I'm watching this Turkish series on Netflix, I guess. Now, she would have never had the opportunity to see that. And she watched all like 150 episodes. So that's the good news. But I think that, you know, I taught at NYU, you know, film school for many, many years. I haven't taught there the last 2 years. As far as my students who are interested in big screen cinema, I'm not sure what I would exactly say these days. And I do think that series are different than movies, than feature films. Series, having directed series, I know that, you know, it's great to get it on the pilot, but after that, being a director for a film series, there is a template that has been laid down, and your job is to follow that template if it's a successful one. So it's a different kind of directing than when you get a one-off, the opportunity to direct a one-off feature film.
Mary, what would you say, you know, how do you talk to your young students about going into the industry?
You know, I encourage my students overall to work and to write things that that only they can write, because one of my fears that I see with the students is that they're writing work that's already out there, that's absolutely patently already being made. And I feel like, you know, I probably am wrong, but I think that it seems to me that there's already people who can do that work. They're not going to be as likely to be hired. And so I do encourage them to try to find a way in that only they can, like, you know, in a way what Susan was saying about point of view, bringing in their point of view and their angle of vision. I find that the students actually need, for all the proliferation of available media, they are not always as well versed in some ways, that perhaps because we have fewer films to watch, it was easier to just go see the ones that were very good. So I think that there's still some, I encourage them to diversify what they look at in movies and the opportunities that you can find in narrative. For example, I was looking at a Claire Denis movie, 33 Shots of Rum. And it was really interesting to me to see how beautifully made that film was. What a film that was really about, with a female lens, a really female perspective, female DP. And yet it was just really a story about how does a young woman who has a really strong relationship with her father, how does she break off that relationship and start a new one with a lover? And yet there was no conflict in the movie. So it was really interesting that narrative could work in such a way that there was no overt, hyper-dramatic conflict in it, but it was structured typically or conventionally. So I do think that students are looking for different ways to tell a story that maybe can underscore their new perspectives and their new expectations, which I think are, they don't want to hold up any sort of patriarchal models or racial models, or they want to break those down. And so they're looking at ways to even narrativize differently. But I do think that they're also falling into some habits that need encouragement to give color and flaws to their characters. That's still something that I see that can be supported.
Yeah, Janet, what do you note from your students?
First of all, I'm teaching a class of 10, and 7 are women, and many of them are women of color. So that was a great start. We'll see what happens after they graduate and what kind of work they're able to get, because with my work with the Academy, we've definitely found that there is a big gap in terms of being able to build a pipeline. There's certainly no shortage of women at film schools now, but how many of them are actually getting work? So in my class, we have a huge variety of projects that they're passionate about. At one end are very, very indie movies that I feel like are very makeable. One wants to make a film about a mural artist who helped spur on the Black Lives Matter movement, and someone else wants to make an indie film in China, whatever. So those I feel like are very manageable, and I feel like I can really help them. There's a portion of the students who are really into giant, fantastical, dystopian stories, and I'm going to have to bring them down to reality about what that means for their getting a job and what it's like to get into a writer's room, you know, which already is extremely difficult, becoming a writer's assistant and how you can get that. And really the only way to do that is to write a lot and have something to show, you know, just or get the project to someone who's very, very well versed in that genre. So it's a huge spectrum. I like Mary, encourage them to find their voice, because I said, as a producer, you have to embody the project in a way. When you go pitch, you need the passion. They will be betting on you as much as the project. So you have to really feel it. And so they have found projects that they really feel and like, and I love their enthusiasm. But there's going to be, in some cases, a longer journey perhaps for them to get their project made than for others. Though, you know, either way, there's a lot of information that I think I can impart about the industry and the choices that they have, and, you know, where they can find their place.
Well, thank you all so much for the work that you do. You may not have had role models when you were in film school, but now you are role models to so many young women and young filmmakers everywhere. Susan Seidelman, thank you so much.
Thank you. It was a pleasure being with you today.
Mary Kuryla, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed the opportunity.
And Janet Yang, thank you.
Thank you, Alicia and TCM. It was a real pleasure to be here.
And you can watch TCM's Women Make Film series from 8 p.m. Eastern tonight. It's sadly our last evening of the series, but you can always catch up on the movies using the Watch TCM app. I'm Alicia Malone. I'll see you soon. Bye.